Isaiah, the 10th chapter this morning. My. Isn't the Lord good?
Amen.
All the time He is a good God. Hallelujah. He's better than me than I deserve. Amen. Hallelujah. Better to me than I deserve. You might deserve it. I don't deserve it. Hallelujah. My. Isaiah the 10th chapter, and I'll tell you the verse here in a minute, but before we do that, I want to share something with you. Brother Donnie Swaggart shared something on Francis and Friends this week that stirred my heart, and I preached along these lines, I think, several years ago, but maybe not exactly in this light. But this morning, I want to talk about the standard bearer. According to Merriam-Webster, this is what the definition for a standard bearer is: one who bears a standard or a banner or a flag. A soldier who is responsible for carrying the flag of his unit or his country, the army in which he is fighting for, his regiment. And in the midst of battles, during the great Indian Wars, and where there was a cavalry, and during the Civil War, and back farther than that, during the times of Romans and the battles that they had in the Old Testament and things like that. And not so much today, maybe, as then, because of the way that the weaponry a lot of times we fight wars and we never set foot on ground. They just bomb them from the sky or whatever. Amen? So it might not be exactly the same way then. But the standard bearer was the one who was in charge of holding the flag up. Amen? Hallelujah. You ever see one of those old westerns with John Wayne or somebody, and you know they're getting attacked and it looks hopeless, and all of a sudden you can hear the bugle ringing out through the air, and the cavalry will come up over the hill, and one of the first things you'll see, it's higher than all of the soldiers, I think, is the flag that the soldier is holding. Amen? Amen. He'll ride on his pony and he'll have the flag something like this. Amen. Hallelujah. My. And it'll be higher than the rest of the army. And one of the reasons for that is, and I'll read some more about that from history here in a minute, is because that, so that the troops could see the direction that the army was traveling. Amen. Follow the flag. Follow the standard bearer. I'll have to straighten that out in a minute. I've got it twisted up. But in the midst of the battle, during these wars, there was a soldier that was called the standard bearer, and he was the one that carried the flag. And the historians say in times of chaos of war, soldiers were told to look for the standard bearer. If one would get confused or lost or strayed from his troop or from his fellow soldiers there that were fighting the battle, he would look for where the flag was at. Because the flag would lead him back to where his troop was at. Because the flag would lead him back to where the battle was at and where his defense was at. So he would look to it because the flag was always supposed to be higher than anything else. Amen? And Brother Donnie told this story, and it touched my heart, and I looked it up and even found out what the soldier's name was. But he told this story that in 1864, in the heat of one of the battles during the Civil War, the standard bearer for this particular troop on the Union side was wounded. He was weak, he was tired, but he refused to let the flag touch the ground. He even came to the point where he was crawling, trying to get back to where his troop was at, trying to climb this hill, and he was on his hands and knees, and he was crawling. But he refused to let the flag touch the ground. He may have been on his belly, I don't know. But he refused to let, he was wounded, he was shot. He was weak, but he refused to let the flag touch the ground. Amen? Hallelujah. It might interest some of you NFL doofuses out there that kneel instead of standing for the national anthem, that this man was an African American. Amen? I shouldn't have called them doofuses. Should have called them morons. But he refused to let the flag touch the ground. Amen? And Brother Donnie said that as he crawled up the hill and some of his fellow soldiers rushed to his aid, as the medics helped him into the tent to see to his wounds because he was battered and he was bruised and he was bleeding and he was weak, said the last thing that he said as he went into the tent was, "I never let the flag touch the ground." Think about that this morning. Talking about the standard bearer who was in charge of raising the flag. We've got a standard to bear this morning. We've got a flag to raise above all and everything else this morning. Amen. The soldier's name was William Harvey Kearny. He was the first African American to receive the Medal of Valor. Of course, he didn't receive it then because of prejudices. It was some 35 years later that they actually awarded him the medal. But because of his bravery and because that he did not allow the flag to touch the ground. Look at verse 17, chapter 10 of Isaiah. The Lord is talking about a time of chaos that would come. It's actually a prophecy that would happen 30 years later whenever death would strike the Assyrian host. When the angel of the Lord would go through and smite some 185,000 of the Assyrian army in one night. It says, "And the light of Israel shall be for a fire, and his Holy One for a flame. And it shall burn and devour his thorns and briars in one day, and shall consume the glory of his forest and of his fruitful field, both soul and body. And they," talking about the people, the army, "shall be as when a standard bearer fainteth. And the rest of the trees," that's in reference to the rest of the men that are left of his forest or of his army, "shall be few. So few," the Bible says, "that a child may write them." Gill's commentary says this about the standard bearer and when he would faint. "Who when he falls," talking about this flag bearer, "the whole company or army is thrown into confusion and flees." Don't let me lose you this morning. John Wesley said this about this passage of Scripture. He said, "They shall be like that of an army when their standard bearer is slain, fallen, or flees away, which strikes a panic into the whole army." I'm going somewhere with this morning. Listen to what this other historian said. "If in the course of a fight, if the soldier was separated from his unit, he would look around until he saw the standard flying high, the flag flying high, and then he would try to get back to where it was at. The standard bearer normally was in close proximity to the unit leader. When the standard fell, the unit members did not have a visual point to rally around or to return, and the possibility that the leader had fallen was great. And the loss of the flag in battle, if it was captured by your enemy, was considered a great victory for the enemy and a great shame for your unit, for your army, for your cause." Amen. "If it was taken away, if it was captured, it was considered a great blow and humiliating to your troop." And as the army of the Lord this morning, I submit to you that we have a standard to bear. We have a flag to raise high above all else this morning. Amen. There is a blood-stained banner of Calvary, the message of the cross, amen, that must be raised higher than anything and everything else. Amen. Hallelujah. Without that, there is no rallying point. Without that, there comes chaos. Without that, there comes false doctrine. Without that, there comes disarray. And that's exactly what we're seeing in the church today. Amen? Disarray, chaos. Why? Because we need standard bearers in our pulpits that will lift high the bloodstained banner of the cross of Calvary, amen, and that will lead the troops of the army of the Lord into the battle that must be fought, amen, hallelujah. But because the standard bearer has fainted, because the standard bearer has laid down the flag, because the standard bearer has fallen, because the standard bearer has given up, we've seen false false doctrine. We've seen chaos and disarray.
Come on. Amen.
In the army of the Lord.
Amen.
Because we need standard bearers, which we don't have in most of our pulpits, that is lifting up the blood-stained banner of the Lord Jesus Christ and His finished work of the cross, so that people will know, hey, there's the standard, amen, that I must follow. There's the standard that leads to victory. Hallelujah! We need standard bearers in our pulpit that will get back, that will get away from the name it and claim it, the grab it and nab it, and the bless it and get it, all of that other stuff, and we'll begin to preach the message of the cross and the gospel of Jesus Christ. The standard bearer has fainted in the land today. And we need standard bearers in our pulpits. We need standard bearers in our pew. Say, oh, preacher, you're really burning the hides of them pastors. Well, listen to me. I ain't done with you yet. We need standard bearers in the pews that'll go out that door and lift Jesus higher. Lift Jesus higher. Lift Him up for the world to see.
Amen.
Why? Because He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto Me. When we lift up anything else, we do not draw them to God. We draw them to self. Oh, let that sink in. Amen. When we lift up the word of faith doctrine, we don't draw them to God. We draw them to man's ability to speak it into existence. When we lift up the psychobabble, the psychology that has moved into churches, we don't lift up. We're not drawing people to God. We're drawing people to self. Self-help. Amen. There's only one message that will draw the lost. There is only one message that will deliver the alcoholic. There is only one message that will set the captive free. There is only one event that broke the back of the devil and shook the foundations of hell and made a way for mankind to enter into the Holy of Holies. And that's not the word of faith. That's not name it and claim it. That's not the power of positive thinking. That's not psychology. That is on a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. Hallelujah. The emblem of suffering and shame. If we'll cling to that old rugged cross, if we'll lift it up in this time of battle, if we'll lift it up in these last days, we will see men and women drawn to that old rugged cross. The only place where they will find the answer that they need. Amen. We need standard bearers. The doctrine of the cross must be exalted higher than any other teaching. Amen. Hallelujah. Because it is that teaching, it is that doctrine. Turn with me this morning to John, the 12th chapter. Talking about standard bearers. This morning, Lord, help us to be a standard bearer this morning. Help us to raise, hallelujah, not a denominational flag, hallelujah, not a organizational flag, but help us to raise up the blood stained banner of the cross of Calvary, so that in the midst of chaos, so in the midst of war, there's a place for the people to rally around. Hallelujah. Did you notice something that historian said? If you got lost from your troop, if you saw the standard bearer lifting the flag high, It was a rallying point. It was a place for you to return to. Glory to God. We need today in our pulpit some standard bearers that'll raise up the old bloodstained banner of Calvary and the finished work of the cross, and will call God's people back, not to a denomination. God forbid, not to the Catholic Church, like many of the organizations and religions are getting together with today, but back to the old rugged cross, back to the place where the blood from the Lamb of God, hallelujah, shed from Emmanuel's veins, stained that old piece of wood and destroyed the sin, hallelujah, that had man bound, hallelujah. Listen to this, John. Now see, John 12, is that where I told you to go?
Yeah.
John 12, 32. Listen what Jesus says. John 12, 32. And if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto Me. This He said, signifying what death He should die. Turn back a few chapters to John, the 3rd chapter. Talking about lifting Jesus high. talking about being a standard bearer this morning. Hallelujah. I couldn't get that out of my mind. Hallelujah. As I studied and prepared for this week's sermon. Hallelujah. That old soldier, wounded and battered. Hallelujah. Broken and torn as he crawled up that hill. Hallelujah. Lifting the flag. Lifting the flag. Hallelujah. One of the historians said he was shot in the side. Said he made it as he made his way across that field on his knees. He had one hand on his side and the other hand holding the flag high in the air. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We need some standard bearers this morning. Amen. That'll lift Jesus higher. I said lift Jesus higher. Hallelujah. John 3 and 14. Jesus' words, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Hallelujah. For whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have eternal life. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Hallelujah. I don't have any proof for this, and this is just my thinking. It may not even be the way that it was, but if you'll give me a little latitude today to think that it might have happened this way. On the hill of Calvary, there were probably, historians say and Bible scholars say, you know, we get the picture that there's Jesus and a thief on each side. But according to most Bible scholars, there were probably multitudes of crosses on the hill that day when Jesus was crucified, because that's the way that they did it. They didn't just crucify one, two, or three. They would crucify the criminals they had that were ready for that they had sentenced to death. They would take them and crucify them at the same time. Regardless, and even if it wasn't this way in the natural, I guarantee you it was this way spiritually. I believe that if you stood back and you looked toward Golgotha's hill, the place of the skull, and you saw those crosses, I think there was one that stood a little higher than the rest. I believe there might have been one that stood, Brother Jim, a little taller than the rest of them.
Amen.
As the banner flew, amen. As the banner waved in the wind. Hallelujah. That would draw all men, that would put faith in what He was doing, what He did there on the cross of Calvary for their salvation. I don't know if it was that way in the natural, Brother Ronnie, but I believe it was that way in the spiritual. I believe when the devil looked, he knew exactly which cross Jesus was on. I don't think he got lost in the crowd. Amen. He knew exactly which one he was on. Amen. Each drop of blood may have sounded like a roll of thunder to the devil. Amen. He tried to stop him, tried to kill him in the garden. Amen. The Bible says he was grieved unto death, that he sweated, he hemorrhaged blood through the pores of his skin. Nobody can tell me that the devil didn't know what was going on. And he tried, before it ever happened, to stop the cross from taking place. Amen. Sure, he enjoyed the punishment. But the outcome would seal his doom. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, go with me to Numbers, the 21st chapter this morning. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And we know that's talking about his death on the cross, but it's also talking about the message of the cross. The message of what was done there. That is the reason that is the only message that will draw people to God is because you can't come to God unless the Holy Spirit draws you. And the only message that the Holy Spirit will use to draw mankind is the message of the cross. Amen. And we need some standard bearers that will wave that bloodstained banner this morning high above everything else. Hallelujah. And call God's people back. Amen. To where the standard is at. Call God's people back to where the message of the cross will set free from religion and from false doctrine, to call a lost and dying world, to point their attention to one thing. That's what we're going to see here. Jesus was making reference to something that happened with Moses and the children of Israel. Whenever he said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And he was talking about this in Numbers, the 21st chapter in the 5th verse. Numbers 21 and 5. And the people spake against God and against Moses. And they said this, wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread. Neither is there any water. And our soul loatheth this light bread. Sound like anybody? It's too cold. It's too hot. Amen? The children of Israel are a perfect picture of man and his inability to be satisfied. We need some meat. Oh, we got too much meat. We need some bread. I'm sick of this bread. Amen? It wouldn't matter who their leader was. They just still complained against him. Moses was probably the first pastor. He couldn't please nobody. Amen? He couldn't please them people. He tried. Didn't work. The Bible says, because of their complaining and because their sin against the Lord, that the Lord sent fiery serpents among them, among the people. They bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Now this was brought on because of their sin. And we all know what the wages of sin is. The wages of sin is death. Verse 7. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he may take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord could have done this anyway. He could have just had the thought and the serpents would have been gone. The sickness would have been healed. He could have healed them anyway. He could have delivered them anyway. But he chose this because he was painting a picture, a foreshadow of that which was to come just outside of Jerusalem, on the hill of Calvary, when Jesus would give his life for mankind. So he chooses a strange way to do it. Doesn't make sense to our carnal mind, but neither does Calvary. Calvary doesn't make sense. It's foolish. Amen. It's foolishness to those who think, to our carnal minds that think, how could Jesus dying on the cross save everyone that puts their faith in him from going to hell? So the Lord chooses a way that will point them to a future event that we today would have for this, to be able to look back and see that this was a picture and a type. And Moses prayed for the people. Verse 8. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent and set it upon a pole. And no doubt he had to lift it high above everything else. Amen? Because we ain't talking about 15, 20 people here. We're talking about a massive number of people. So it had to be lifted high. Jesus said, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, that means he lifted it up high, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Amen? Listen to what he says. Make thee a fiery serpent, set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that every man that is bitten, if he's good enough, if he'll do enough good works, if he'll do enough good deeds, that's not what my Bible says. Everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole, and no doubt lifted it high, as the other scripture says. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. Amen? So get the picture, if you will. This is the only demonstration thing that I have. This is not the serpent, but the standard Moses makes, according to the word of the Lord, this brass serpent, puts it on this pole and lifts it up high. There's a ceiling up there. And lifts it up high. Probably wasn't one in the wilderness, was it? And he said, everyone that looks upon this serpent shall live. Now this serpent had bitten them. Not the brass one, but the others. Amen. So now they see this brass serpent on this pole, lifeless. Amen. Because there was no life in that serpent that was there. This serpent that had bitten them. See, man was bitten. Adam and Eve were bitten by, in a sense, by the serpent in the Garden of Eden. They were bitten spiritually. And that would bring spiritual death, brought natural death as well, but it would bring spiritual death without a remedy, amen? These people were bitten, and it brought natural death because of their sin. Adam and Eve were bitten by the snake spiritually. All mankind has been bitten by the same snake that bit Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. All of mankind is lost and undone without God. But thank God, today we have a remedy. The remedy that God laid out there was a picture and a type of the remedy that would come that we look back at now. Amen? Lift the serpent up high, and whoever looks at it, and you had to do it by faith. It had to be by faith or you wouldn't look. Well, that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. I'm not looking at that old snake on that pole. Yeah, you'll die too. Amen? But if you'll look, you'll live. If we'll lift up the blood-stained banner of the cross of Calvary today to the lost and the dying, to the snake-bitten that are dying because of sin, hallelujah, and going to hell, if they will look in faith believing as we lift up the blood-stained banner above everything else and exalt the message of the cross, if they'll look in faith believing, they too shall live. Amen? They too shall live. I have eternal life this morning, not because I signed a church book, not because I joined a denomination, not because I shook a preacher's hand, but because I knelt at an old-fashioned altar and said, Jesus, be merciful unto me, a sinner. I believe that you died on the old rugged cross, and I'm looking to that blood-stained banner for my hope and for my peace and for my salvation. That's the only hope for mankind. So why is the church stumbling around in darkness, lifting everything else up? Amen? Brother Billy, you're hard on the church. Yeah, that's because 98% of them are backslid. That's right. They have turned away from the cross. The only hope for mankind. And they're lifting up a standard. They're lifting up a banner. But it's the wrong one. Amen? You remember what I told you, what the historian said? That if an opposing army came in and they stole your standard, they stole your flag, that was a great victory for them. It's a great victory for the devil today when you do not preach the message of the cross. It brings chaos and disarray to the body of Christ. I believe, and you might can contradict me on this, and if you're right, then I'll say so. I believe that every false doctrine was birthed because of the church turning away from the cross.
Amen.
Because the church turned away and looked for other means. Whether it be for salvation or sanctification or justification. All my hope is in Jesus.
Amen.
Thank God my yesterdays are gone. What's the next thing, Tyler?
All my sins are forgiven.
Because I've been washed in the blood.
Amen.
All my hope is in Jesus.
Amen.
Thank God my yesterday's gone, and all my sins are forgiven, 'cause I've been washed in the blood.
Amen.
Amen. That is the only message that can set the captive free.
That's why we have church people that go to church Sunday and go to church Wednesday, but they're bound, amen, and they don't have the freedom that God wants them to have, because there's only one message that will set you free, and that is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Hallelujah. Only one message that will cause the drunkard to come in drunk, bound by alcohol, and kneel down at an old-fashioned altar, turn his life over to God, and get up sober and never touch another drink. You don't have to go and stand in a room of people and say, "Hello, my name's Billy, and I'm an alcoholic." You can go and you can stand in the front of the church or in your pew and say, "Hello, I used to be an alcoholic, hallelujah, but I ain't one no more, hallelujah. I used to be a drug addict, but I ain't one no more. I used to be a sinner, wretched and vile without God, but I ain't no more." Amen. Why? Because someone pointed me to the standard. Because someone lifted Jesus higher than anything else. John said, "I must decrease that He may increase." Amen. He said, "Moses, take and make a brass serpent, put it on the pole and lift it high. And you tell the people, he that looks shall live." Amen. He that looks shall live. Mankind was bitten by a serpent. Amen. And that bite brings death. But I'm a good person. A lot of good people sadly went to hell because being good is not enough. Amen. Hallelujah. But I'm religious. Oh, Lord, help us. A lot of religious people in hell and on their way this morning. Amen. Because religion cannot save you. You know what religion does? Makes you more miserable. Because you're always thinking, "Yeah, I did just enough. Oh no, I messed up. Amen. Guess I wasn't saved after all." Religion can't do it. It'd make you miserable. Amen. It's like banging your head against a brick wall. You never get anywhere. All you get is a headache. The bloodstained banner of the cross of Calvary, just like there for the children of Israel, there was only one remedy. The Lord didn't give them three or four remedies. He didn't say, "Okay, Moses, tell them, make the serpent, put it on the pole, tell those that will look, they can live. And if they don't want to look, there's an elixir they can mix up. There's something they can fix with their own hand. They can just tough it out. Some of them are good enough. They don't have to do this thing." No, he said, "There's one remedy. You'll do this or you will die. You will come to Jesus Christ by way of what he did on the cross of Calvary, or you will die and go to hell. I take no comfort, no joy or happiness in telling you that this morning. There is still a hell that burns forever and forever. And all those that reject Jesus Christ and the price that he paid on Calvary will find themselves there for eternity." Amen. I gotta go. I gotta move on here. I gotta leave some of the tank for tonight. Only one remedy. There's only one remedy today, and we must lift him up and proclaim his finished work as the only means of life, as the only means of salvation, sanctification, justification, deliverance, healing, whatever it is that you need was made possible by the cross of Calvary and what he did there. Amen. I'm closing. As a standard bearer in the army of the Lord, we must lift the blood-stained banner of the cross of Calvary high so that all who look upon it, all that will put their faith therein, shall not die, but they shall live. I've seen these churches, and I don't know too much about it, so I won't make a lot of reference to it, but I've seen some of them, they'll come across there waving all these banners. Has anybody seen that before? It's part of their worship or something. They'll come through there waving all these banners. I think Brother Donnie said he saw some poor guy in the church he was in got hit in the head with the flagpole, but anyway, that was in the pew. And they'll wave those banners. And sadly, The banner that needs to be waved is nowhere to be found. Amen. Even to the point where some of the mega churches will not have a cross. Now, I know there's no healing power in that. There's no saving power in that. But some of the modern day churches will not even have a cross in their sanctuary because they're afraid they will offend the Muslims. The gospel offends those who refuse to accept it. That's not my fault. That's not on me. That's on you. There's no power in that wooden beam, but we certainly are not going to take it down to keep from offending somebody. Amen. It is the only hope for mankind. I'm closing. 2 Timothy, the 4th chapter. As I studied this and as I thought about that Union soldier, I couldn't get the picture out of my mind of how he must have looked. He probably looked pretty rough. Been shot, been wounded. Probably skin scraped and bleeding and bruised and worn as he crawled up that hill on his hand and his knees with one hand holding the flag up high. And the words that he said as they took him into the medic's tent, I never let the flag touch the ground. And I got to thinking about this, Brother Jim. When I get to the end of my journey, whether it's by way of the grave or by the rapture, no doubt I'm going to be battle weary, worn and wounded. And I pray, Lord, this morning there are going to be times that I fall. There are going to be times that I've scraped, but there are going to be miles that I might have had to crawl. But Lord, don't ever let me let the banner touch the ground. Amen. I may stumble and I may fall and I may mess up and I'll scrape my knees and I'll be wounded. And I'll be weak at times, but Lord, don't ever let me let down and stop preaching the message of the cross. Don't ever let me stop pointing people to Calvary. May it be my testimony and your testimony this morning as we cross over. Lord, I struggled. Lord, I had to crawl the last mile of the way. But I never let the flag touch the ground. Amen. Oh, I hope you can get that this morning. 2 Timothy 4 and 6. This is the Apostle Paul's testimony. And whoever does my funeral, honey, they got to read this scripture. For I am now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. This soldier had fought a good fight that we talked about this morning. I finished my course. He made it to the top of the hill. I have kept the faith. I didn't let the flag touch the ground. Hallelujah. I didn't let the flag touch the ground. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. Not to me only, but unto all them also that love is appearing. Oh, I didn't let the flag touch. You'll find better preachers than me. You'll find better Christians than me. You'll find people who live it better than me. And you may find people who don't struggle as much as I do, or have fallen as much as I have, or have as many bruises and battle scars as I've got. But I pray this morning that as I finish my journey, I can testify through the power of the Holy Spirit and the grace of God that I fell and I had to crawl and I was bruised, battered, and wounded. But I never let the flag touch the ground. I never stopped pointing people to Calvary's cross. Help me sing this chorus this morning as we close. Lift Jesus higher. Lift Jesus higher. Lift Him up for the world to see. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Oh, go out that door and be the standard bearer that you're supposed to be.
Amen.
Amen. Lift Jesus higher than anything and anyone else. Amen. Hallelujah. Someone else this morning. Have something before we go.